with a quick introduction. So it really gives me distinct pleasure to introduce Dr. Panos Markopoulos from the Electrical Engineering Department at the Rush Institute of Technology. Panos joined RIT about 5 or 6 years ago. He received his PhD from University of Buffalo, and I know he did his BS and MS back in Greece. And since joining RIT, he has done an exceptionally well, developed an exceptionally a well-established research program, as well as has been doing, you know, the various teaching and service, but he has really done an exceptional job in establishing an externally funded research program. And I've really had the distinct pleasure of working with Panos over the last 2-3 years on a joint grant together. So today, Panos is going to present some of the results from our work in that particular grant. So I'm going to, without further ado, I'm going to turn this over to Panos so he can tell us about the recent advances in tensor subspace analysis based on absolute projections. Panos, are you ready?
I'm ready, yes. Thank you very much for your kind words, Dr. Saber. In your introduction, it's a great pleasure to be here and in the seminar of CIS to present recent advances in tensor subspace analysis based on absolute projections. This is an outline of my presentation. I will start with motivation, with few remarks on the motivation, applications, terminology, and operations for tensor data. Then I will present what is a Tucker tensor structure, and what is a Tucker tensor decomposition? We will see how tensor decomposition is affected by outliers, and this way we will motivate our research on a robust alternative to Tucker decomposition, which we term as L1 norm Tucker decomposition. So I will show you the formulation. I will present exact algorithms for special cases of the problem. And then I will also present general algorithms that can tackle the problem in general cases. And then I will introduce a new algorithm that we developed that has the ability to operate on streaming data. And therefore it's appropriate for streaming data applications, but also applications where we have limited computational and storage resources. Finally, I will draw some concluding remarks about our work. So let me start with an overview of the motivation, applications, terminology, and operations for tensor data. So really, tensors are multi-way arrays. For example, a tensor is an n-way array of scalars, each of which is identified by n indices. A three-way tensor looks like a cube, as you have it there on the side, this green shape. You need three coordinates to identify every entry of that cube. And an example of such a tensor could model, for example, a hyperspectral image, where the two dimensions would model the coordinates of a pixel, and the third dimension would represent the index of the frequency band. A two-way tensor is simply a matrix, as you have it here on the right, this red shape. And that could be, for example, a grayscale image. And then a one-way tensor is simply a vector. And that could be any measurement, typically in standard processing that does not involve tensors, we like to vectorize or to convert into a vector any measurement, for example, an image, right? And so in essence, this also falls into the category of tensors, but it's a one-way tensor. Now, why do we want to operate straight on tensors? In this talk, we will be operating straight on tensors without vectorizing them, right? So we want to maintain this high order structure that tensors have. The reason is that in this structure, there are interdependencies of the tensor captured and maintained. And if we disrupt this structure, then these interdependencies are not obvious anymore, are not there anymore. So in the structure, there are interdependencies among the data that essentially allow for better operation on them. So better, for example, compression, better component analysis, better understanding of the data that we have. And that is why tensors have found many applications to date. For example, in video, image and video processing, in multi-spectral or hyperspectral images, as I explained earlier, in network data analysis, and more recently also, they have found extensive application in modeling and optimizing neural networks. Because those of you that have worked with neural networks know that tensors naturally emerge in the formation of weights within neural networks, for example. And tensor processing has really demonstrated many merits in that area as well. So a few things about terminology now. In the same way that a matrix has columns and rows, a tensor has fibers. And since now we have multiple modes in a tensor, we have mode one fibers, mode two fibers, mode three fibers, etc. For example, if our tensor was a matrix and we had only two modes, then mode one fibers would be the columns and mode two fibers would be the rows. But in general, we can have, you know, mode n fibers. And an important point here is that in the SQL, I will be talking about tensor operations. So operations on tensors. And I will be using notation and operations on what we call multilinear algebra. So the same way we have linear algebra to determine operations between vectors and between matrices, multilinear algebra is the extension that handles operations between tensors. However, there is a link there, and operations between tensors or operations between matrices and tensors really can be converted into operations between matrices, but these operations are what we call tensor operations. For example, you may have heard of the Kronecker product or the Khatri-Rao product. These are matrix products that essentially perform tensor operations. So there is a link between tensors and matrices, and a connection between the two is through the task of matricization or unfolding. So another term for that is flattening. So it is the operation of taking a tensor and converting it into a matrix, by rearranging basically its entries or by reshaping it, as we can say. Now, of course, this can happen in many, many different ways, right? So if I give you a tensor and I ask you to rearrange its entries in the form of a matrix, there are multiple ways by which you can do this. But there is a convention here in the literature, and we have a specific way for arranging the fibers or the entries of a tensor when we do a matricization. And we have mode one matricization or mode one unfolding, when we take all the mode one fibers of the tensor and arrange them one next to the other, creating a matrix. So use them as columns of a matrix. And then we have mode two unfolding when we take the mode two fibers and arrange them as columns of a matrix, right? So for any given tensor, there are more than one ways to matricize it. We can do one matricization per mode, right? And this is defined. I have here the details on how exactly this convention is defined, but they will not be of great importance for the SQL of this talk. Now I want to talk a little bit about what is a Tucker tensor structure and what is a Tucker decomposition. So here on the top of this slide, you see a tensor X, that's a three-way tensor with dimensions D1 by D2 by D3. And then I'm saying that this is equal to this operation between matrices and tensor that I have on the right. So on the right, you see a smaller tensor G, this orange color, and then you see three matrices in blue color. So this operation is a matrix tensor product. Actually, there are three matrix tensor products. So you have a small tensor, which we call it core, And we expanded by doing a multiplication on each of its modes by a tall matrix that is the basis of that tensor. Okay, so you can see that down at the equation right under the schematic, you will see that X is equal to G, where G is the core. And then you have a product there. This product is times underscore N is the what we call the mode N product. So it's the multiplication of tensor G on its nth mode with basis UN. And we do that for all the modes. That's why I say there, n-way product for n taking any value from 1 to n capital. That's this n in bracket n capital, right? This means multi-way product across all modes with basis un. So you can see it in expanded form on the right for a general case of n-way tensors. Now, does every tensor have such a structure? The answer is no. Indeed, a way by which trivially every tensor could have such a structure is if I set those basis matrices U to identity, and I set this G core tensor equal to X. So that's a trivial case. But in general, not every tensor has a Tucker structure. The benefit of a Tucker structure is that such a tensor that has a Tucker structure is highly compressible. So a Tucker structure in a way represents a low rank. And the notion of rank is not the same in tensors as it is in matrices, but conceptually, the tensor that you see here, this Tucker structure tensor has low rank. And as you know, things that have low rank actually are reducible in their dimensions. They're compressible with minimum, if any, loss. So that's a good thing to have tensor data that have some Tucker structure. Now, even if they do not have a Tucker structure, in many cases, they can be well approximated by a Tucker structure. All right, so you have a general tensor X. That tensor could be, for example, a hyperspectral image. And then I'm asking myself, could I compress it in a way that preserves most of the information within it, so I'm not losing much, but at the same time, I'm reducing significantly the number of parameters that are stored. So that's one use of Tucker. So this operation of actually rewriting a tensor X as a Tucker product, which can be exact if the tensor did have Tucker structure, or approximate if the tensor had approximately Tucker structure, we call that Tucker decomposition. And so the decomposition is that I give you X and you return U1, U2, U3, and G. And as I said, this can be good because if X had a Tucker structure, then you retrieve it and you do not use any unnecessary storage resources. If the tensor did not have a Tucker structure, then you approximate it by one that has Tucker structure, and therefore you compress it with some control loss. So you can control the size of G, and by controlling the size of G, you're controlling how much you're losing. Also, you can use it for denoising, because in many cases, the system model, the signal model, the data model is such that the data do have low rank structure. But then when we collect the data and we browse through the data and we analyze them, we figure out that actually they do not have exactly Tucker structure. And the reason is that there has been some noise, some undesired noise added to that data, disrupting their Tucker structure. So by Tucker decomposition, we actually retrieve the Tucker structure and suppress or eliminate the noise. So it's also used for denoising. And finally, it can be used for model identification and parameter estimation, because this basis and this core could represent parameters that are of interest for a specific engineering application. For example, if this tensor contains measurements that I collect from a planar array of antennas, I can use this basis U1, U2, U3 in order to find the angle of arrival of a particular object. So these bases serve as principal components by which I can do what is called music angle of arrival estimation. So we can, so the third function here is that I can use this basis in order to do parameter estimation. Now let me formulate the Tucker decomposition. Given a tensor X, I'm trying to find a core tensor G and basis matrices U, such as to approximate as closely as possible X by another tensor of Tucker structure, which is G times UN for all values of N. So this way is the error minimization formulation of Tucker. Another formulation which is equivalent is the projection maximization. So instead of looking for G and U to minimize that error, just look for U for the basis to maximize the Frobenius norm of that projection. And we can prove that if you solve the problem at the bottom, if you find the basis that maximize the projection, then the best core G for the problem at the top actually is given by projecting X on those bases. Right. So we can break the problem. What I mean to say is we can break the problem in two steps. First, find the basis by maximum projection, and then retrieve the core G by projecting X on those bases. And this is pretty much the standard Tucker formulation. And you will find papers, in some papers people present it as the error minimization. In other papers, people present it as the projection maximization. But both expressions are equivalent. Another way that we can extend this decomposition is by processing jointly many tensors. So you see here we have one tensor X and we try to find the basis that decompose it, let's say. If those bases were indeed critical for a parameter estimation, then you may want to apply this tensor decomposition on more than one tensors. So you have not just one tensor X, but you have X1, X2, X3, you have multiple tensors, right? And you want to jointly decompose them in order to extract the collection of bases that represents them all. In this way, Tucker decomposition is extended into Tucker 2 decomposition, and it looks like how you see it there at the bottom. Basically, it's a similar metric, but we have a sum of such similar metrics. And in every term of the summation, you have a different tensor, right? So this is a joint decomposition of multiple tensors. Now, how do you solve Tucker decomposition? There are basically two algorithms in the literature that are widely used. The first algorithm is called higher order singular value decomposition. So the method does what it says. Essentially, it tries to extend SVD from matrices to tensors. At this point, I should mention that really Tucker decomposition is one of the ways to extend matrix decomposition, so SVD, singular value decomposition, from matrices to tensors, right? So Tucker is in some ways a high order SVD. And that's why this method also has the same name, high order SVD. Now, when you want to extend SVD from matrices to tensors, you have more than one ways. One of those ways is Tucker. Another way that people use in the literature is a parafac. They call it parafac, parallel factor analysis extension. But this is beyond the scope of this talk, where we focus solely on Tucker. So this method, higher order singular value decomposition, finds the bases disjointly. That is, we take tensor X, we flatten it across its mode, let's say the nth mode, and then we formulate on it, on this flattening, which is now a matrix, we formulate standard singular value decomposition. So we're looking for the basis, for the principal components, basically, of this flattening, right? And I have here the formulation of this problem in red font. This, of course, can happen in parallel. So you can have n parallel flattenings of X, and for its flattening, do principal component analysis by means of SVD and get the principal components. And the principal components of its flattening is the corresponding basis, or you can use it as the as an estimate of the corresponding Tucker basis for that mode. The problem here, of course, is that this computation of the basis is disjoint, and that goes against the formulation of the problem where the bases are to be found jointly. However, it's an approximate, of course, low-cost variant, a low-cost algorithm that can approximately solve the problem by n parallel SVDs. Another method is called higher order orthogonal iterations. This method is different than the previous because it finds the bases jointly. To do that, it initializes all the bases and considers all bases fixed. Then it takes the tensor, projects it to the fixed bases in every mode, apart from the mode of interest, let's say the first mode, and then it flattens that projected tensor across mode one. So it does a mode one flattening of the projected tensor, and then solves again, I have it here in red font, it solves SVD for that flattened tensor. So the difference with the previous is that now this flattened tensor contains the basis for the other modes, while previously it did not. And that this way we update our basis for mode one. Then we fix this new basis for mode one. We fix every basis for mode three, four, and above. We flatten the tensor across mode two, and we solve again with an SVD for mode two. And we continue doing that in an alternating fashion. So we fix all bases apart from one, and we find that one by doing SVD on the flattening of the core projected on the other fixed basis. And we continue that in an alternating fashion, base from updating basis one, basis two, basis three, all the way to basis n. And then we go back to the beginning in a circular way, and we start updating again basis one, basis two, etc. So this is a very popular algorithm, was introduced about 20 years ago, and it's called higher order orthogonal iterations, or HOOI. This algorithm is as popular in tensor processing, almost, you know, as SVD is for matrix processing. The benefit of this algorithm is that if you initialize it to the solution of HOSVD, then you are guaranteed to get a higher value to the metric, to the projection metric. And this is because at every iteration, this algorithm provably increases the metric. Now, I think after this introduction on Tucker decomposition, let me show you what works well and what doesn't work well about it. So one thing that works well with Tucker is that when the data indeed have a Tucker structure, so this small core and bases across its mode, this formulation, Tucker formulation, does a great job in finding the core and the bases. And actually, it can do a very great job in denoising and a great job in compressing, etc. However, it does not work so well when the data contain outliers or errors of high variance. So let me show you an example here. I consider a three-way tensor X, and I corrupt, or you know, I additively corrupt with a noise of high variance, just a single entry. Right, so this tensor, you know, can be 10 by 10 by 10. It will have 1,000 entries, and I corrupt just a single one. And correspondingly, if I flatten that tensor across mode one, this column, the column that I have highlighted here, will contain somewhere here this corrupted entry. So the entire column is corrupted just because it contains the corrupted entry somewhere here. And if I flatten this tensor across mode two, then again, there will be a column in this flattening that contains this corrupted metric. And that would be essentially a corrupted column. And if I flatten this across mode three, again, there will be a column that contains this corrupted entry, right? So even a single corrupted entry in the tensor corrupts one column of any flattening of it. All right, so now let me write here the Tucker formulation, the projection maximization formulation. You see it down here at the bottom left. And this can be written as summation of absolute value of a summation of terms, right? So I'm just expanding here this Frobenius norm of the tensor. I'm writing it as a summation of absolute, of squared absolute values of summations. And you will see here something important. This entry, this I1, I2, I3 entry that was corrupted, it will appear here in one of the summation terms. any entry of x will participate to this metric, and any entry of x will have a squared emphasis up here. So same as any other metric, any other entry, the corrupted entry will have a squared emphasis up there. Now, this squared emphasis tends to benefit higher values, right? Because it's a quadratic function, it's not a linear function. So it benefits more emphatically higher values. So this outlier, which will have a high value compared to the other entries, will be quadratically benefited. Let me give you a numerical example. I consider this x to have to be 10 by 10 by 10. And I say, I'm assuming that it doesn't really have any Tucker structure. Indeed, I'm picking all entries independently from standard normal distribution of mean zero and variance one. And then I additively corrupt one entry, the entry 3, 3, 4, with a point again from zero mean Gaussian distribution, but of a much higher variance. And then I decompose X to obtain three bases. So I choose to do the decomposition for one component per mode. What I want to measure is the fitness of each component from its mode to the corresponding corrupted fiber across that mode. Remember that one fiber, one column across its flattening will be corrupted. So I want to see in few words how the components that Tucker decomposition returns fit to the corrupted fibers, and therefore how much sensitive is this decomposition to the corruption. So I'm doing that, I measure F of mu squared. Mu squared is the variance of the outlier. And I repeat this experiment 3000 realizations. And then I plot the average value of F of mu squared over mu squared. And you see here that the fit of the components to the corrupted fibers increases quickly as high as 84 or 80, close to 85%, right? As mu increases from 0 to 100. So this 100 means that the outliers or the corruption is 10 times stronger than the average measurement. So even when the corruption is 10 times stronger than the average measurement, Tucker essentially returns bases that fit 84% to the corrupted fibers. For that reason, we are motivated to redesign Tucker in a way that would be more robust or more resistant against high variance corruptions. To do that, we remove the squared emphasis that used to be here on the absolute. So instead of doing summation of magnitude squares, we do summation of absolute values. And we do that in this extended form. And then we bring it back together into a tensor norm form. And this tensor norm that we end up having here is an L1 norm. So we call that L1 norm Tucker decomposition. This is the problem that we want to solve now, this blue formulation here, the bottom right. The question is how to solve this problem. So I will show you what is the progress of our group over the past couple of years on this problem. So on the top left, you see L1 Tucker. This is in the blue background. And then on the pink background, I have L1 Tucker 2. The difference between the two is that with L1 Tucker, I'm trying to decompose a single tensor. With L1 Tucker 2, I'm trying to decompose jointly a collection of tensors. Now, for L1 Tucker, I may want to do it because this tensor X is a tensor that I want to compress or denoise. And for L1 Tucker 2, I may want to formulate this problem because I want to estimate the source subspaces that describe all those tensor measurements. So all these XIs correspond to the same bases, and these are the bases that I'm looking for. So I'm going to jointly process them all in order to have a better chance to find those bases. For example, for the application of direction finding with planar arrays. Now, there is a connection in the two formulations. For example, if the number of measurements M in L1 Tucker 2 is equal to 1, then L1 Tucker 2 becomes L1 Tucker. Obviously, that's a trivial a trivial way to go from L1 tucker 2 to L1 tucker. But there is another way also. If I add a constraint to L1 tucker for one of those bases to be equal to identity, then essentially this L1 tucker becomes an L1 tucker 2 problem of tensors of one lower mode, right? So of one lower dimensionality. So these two problems are connected. And if you give me an algorithm that solves L1 tucker, then I can solve L1 tucker 2. Conversely, if you give me an algorithm that solves L1 tucker 2, I can solve any instance of L1 tucker. So it doesn't matter which of the two problems you want to focus on. Essentially, if you solve one, you solve the other also. Now, what kind of algorithms are there for this? There are approximate algorithms. A very early work on specifically for L1 tucker 2, when these Xi's were not tensors, but really were matrices. So in a matrix simplified version of the problem, was started back in 2010. But this is kind of a trivial case, right? When Xi's become matrices, they're not tensors anymore. So a more general formulations that actually operate on tensor measurements Xi started later after 2015. And we have made very good progress in this area with my research team in the past couple of years. So what you can find now in the literature, including our works, is approximate algorithms to solve L1 tucker and L1 tucker 2. But you solve it approximately. And sometimes we have also guarantees. We have exact solution of the problem for special cases. And then we're working now on finding the exact solution for the general problem. Let me point here that finding the exact solution for the general problem is a very difficult task. The problem is very challenging, but it has a great math interest. And I think that if one finds the solution to L1 tucker, then lots of other problems that appear in numerical optimization also will become simpler. So it's a very important, let's say, problem to solve. All right, so let me show you now the special cases. First special case is when you consider that this you formulate L1 tucker 2, but your measurements are not tensors, they're vectors. So they're order one tensors. A very special case apparently, which essentially boils down to vector processing, not tensor processing. But for this case, we have shown that the problem becomes equivalent to L1 norm PCA of a matrix that contains these vector measurements. This L1 PCA is a problem that my group has been working on for the past few years. And we have all kinds of algorithms. Importantly, we have the exact solution to L1 PCA. Therefore, for this special case where the tensors are vectors, we have the exact solution also to L1 tucker 2. Just very briefly, I want to show you that essentially we have proven that when you have L1 PCA of a matrix, this is an equivalent problem of trying to find the binary matrix B that maximizes this nuclear norm. And of course, because the feasibility set is finite, this is just a combinatorial problem, right? So if one evaluates all possible plus minus one combinations in matrix B, then one can find the exact solution to the problem. So the problem is combinatorial, and therefore the exact solution can be found at least with exhaustive search. So this is the simplest, conceptually simplest approach. However, we have in reference 11, we have also faster algorithms that can solve the problem exactly. So if one manages to solve this binary nuclear norm maximization exactly, then from the solution of this problem, I can go back to the solution of L1 PCA simply through an SVD. So you see that phi operation here takes as argument a matrix and returns the nearest orthonormal matrix. This is what people call the Procrustes problem, right? So we find the Procrustes orthonormal basis that is nearest to X times B opt, where B opt is the binary matrix that solves the binary nuclear norm maximization. And this solution of the Procrustes problem is actually my L1 PCA basis for this collection of order one tensors. So we have the exact solution for a very special case. And then more recently, we found the exact solution for another special case where now our measurements are not anymore vectors. Our measurements now are matrices. So they are two-way measurements. And I'm looking for components for mode one and mode two, but I'm looking only for one component per mode. So this is why this is a special case, because the measurements are matrices and we're looking for one component per mode. And we have also shown in a paper we wrote in 2018 that, again, I can rewrite this problem as a combinatorial problem, which I can solve also efficiently. I mean, a combinatorial problem is a hard problem, but we have ways under some mild assumptions to solve it more efficiently. And we saw that if you solve that combinatorial problem, then through a simple SVD operation, you can get the solution to L1 Tucker. All right, these are the special cases for which we have exact solution, but for all the other general cases, we do not have an exact solution. All right, so but instead of an exact solution, we have approximate algorithms that we have developed and work quite nicely. So the first algorithm that we have is the L1 norm HOSVD. So remember, I present to you HOSVD, a method that was presented a few years back specifically for Tucker. Now we have created the L1 norm HOSVD, which is specifically for L1 Tucker. But the concept is the same. We decompose by means of L1 PCA every flattening of the tensor in parallel, so disjointly. And then we use this L1 PCA solutions as an approximation for the L1 Tucker basis. Same to HOSVD, this method being disjoint, it fails to capture the joint notion of the metric. So we have to find also something that finds the basis jointly, as I will show later on. Now, when it comes to solving L1 PCA for a specific flattening, we don't have to solve this L1 PCA exactly. The method itself does not claim to be an exact method, right? Because it finds the basis disjointly anyways. So we don't have to solve this problem exactly. We can solve it approximately. And we have a very strong algorithm that can solve L1 PCA approximately with very low cost, similar to the cost of singular value decomposition and very high performance. So when I solve L1 PCA for its basis here, I use that algorithm, which we call L1BF, which means L1 PCA with bit flipping, L1BF. Another algorithm that we have is an algorithm that finds all the bases jointly. And that we do it again through alternating optimization. So we fix all bases apart from one. We project X, the tensor, on these fixed bases. And then we flatten that and we do L1 PCA again by means of bit flipping. So the L1BF, we don't have to solve L1 PCA exactly in this case either. And we continue with this alternating optimization iteratively until convergence. Convergence is guaranteed, and because we know that at every iteration, we will be increasing the L1 metric, the L1 Tucker metric, and we know that the L1 Tucker metric is upper bounded. So we know that we will converge in a finite number of iterations. Also, if we initialize to the solutions of L1 HOSVD, then we will get much better bases. The benefit of this method is that it optimizes the basis jointly instead of disjointly as L1 HOSVD. So here is a schematic illustration of this kind of alternating optimization. So starting from here, so we start here, we're given a tensor X and we fix all the bases, and then we project this X on all the bases different than one. We flatten this projection and we solve L1 PCA. And then we go to basis two, basis three, all the way to basis N. And then we go back to the beginning. So this is a schematic illustration of L1 HOY. Now, we currently have a collaboration with the AFRL in which we're exploring generalization of this algorithm for other orders of updates, right? So when we have different orders that can be, for example, random or selected. So we're currently, one of my students is working on trying to find a preferred different order or a customized order per tensor. All right, let me give you some experimental studies. So here we consider that we have a measurement, we have tensor measurements that include noise and outliers. And these tensor measurements have a Tucker structure that we're looking for. The noise is just additive white Gaussian noise drawn from standard normal distribution. And the outliers are also zero mean Gaussian, independent, but of much higher variance possibly than that of the noise. And they do not corrupt all entries, but rather few entries of the tensor. Therefore, this tensor O that contains the outliers is a sparse tensor. Our goal is to process X in a way that will allow us to obtain XS, right? So we want to approximate XS, the Tucker structured original tensor, by processing the available corrupted tensor X. And we do that by means of HOSVD, HOOI, L1HOSVD, and L1HOOI. And then we plot, we measure and plot the mean normalized squared error. So something like the mean squared error, right? But we normalize it also of the reconstruction. And here I have two figures. In one figure, we vary the number of outliers, the number of corrupted entries with outliers in X. And in the other figure, we vary the standard deviation of the outliers. And you see that when the data are clean, when the data have no outliers, the blue methods, which are the standard Tucker methods, and the red methods, which are the L1 Tucker methods, the proposed methods, they both exhibit very low error. Right, they perform similarly with very low error. But as the number of outliers increases, the standard Tucker methods get significantly, tremendously affected, and they break down, while the proposed L1 Tucker methods remain robust and resist the corruption. Similarly, in this figure to the right, when the variance of the outliers increases, again, the standard Tucker breaks down, the L1 Tucker maintains robustness. Then I have another experiment that is on real data. We do phase classification using the AT&T phase data set just to demonstrate how Tucker compression as a pre-processing before classification can actually improve performance, and especially L1 Tucker being robust against corruption. So what we do is we take the faces and we train a KNN, K nearest neighbor classifier. And then we project on those on the bases that we find with Tucker and L1 Tucker, and we test the classifier on that. We also consider corruption for every image with salt and pepper, and every pixel is corrupted with salt and pepper with probability 10%. And we plot the classification accuracy as the probability of the pixel corruption probability increases. You see that the tensor-based methods have better performance than KNN. So it gives you a benefit to do tensor processing instead of taking the image, vectorizing it, and do just KNN on the vectorized images. So that's one thing that we see from here. The other thing is, again, that as every method becomes worse when you start adding salt and pepper, the L1 methods are more robust than the L2 methods. All right, so then I want to show you a very recent work that is still, it's submitted for publication to JSTSP, General Selected Topics in Signal Processing of IEEE. So it's under revision, but I want to give you some hints on how one can do L1 Tucker when you have tensor data that arrive in a streaming way. So what if the M tensor measurements arrive in a streaming way, right? So this is a main question. And this can happen because, for example, you want to apply subspace tracking in a dynamic environment. And then also you may want to process your measurements in an incremental way in the case that you have many measurements and it makes joint measurement processing computationally prohibitive. So in these two ways, for these two reasons, you want to do incremental online or streaming L1 Tucker. But also I'm calling this dynamic L1 Tucker because if the streaming measurements come from a source that is changing, so the true subspaces of the source are changing, I want to be able to capture that change. So that's why we call it a dynamic L1 Tucker. So here's a schematic of what I just presented, where we have a stream of a tensor data stream. And then we take one measurement, one tensor at a time, and we update our basis, the basis that we calculate. And then how do we do that? We do that informed by the current measurement, but also informed, of course, by the previous basis that we have, right? So a very standard streaming update framework. Okay, so this algorithm, we call it DL1 tagger, dynamic L1 tagger, and works as follows. It takes an initialization batch, which is optional, so some tensor measurements to begin with, optionally, and we do L1 tagger. But in this way, we get a warm start. So we get some first basis that we could use. Of course, if this initialization batch is very large, then that defeats the purpose of a streaming solution, right? So this batch initialization, this initial batch is not expected to be very large. Just it gives us a little bit of a warm start in terms of initializing our basis. And then we process data in a streaming way. So every time we collect a new tensor measurement, before we take it in for processing, we're evaluating its reliability. So you see here where I say the pass is a module that evaluates the reliability of XI. How do we evaluate XI? We evaluate it based on its fit to the currently calculated basis. So how good is this new measurement with regards to the basis that we currently have? And then if this measurement is well described or above a threshold, well described by this basis, then we take it in for processing. If it is very much different from the basis we currently have, we reject it. This is the main principle. And then we keep a fixed memory batch in which we put this new measurement and then we do L1 tagger on this memory batch. This is the idea of this approach. I will not get into many details. This approach has a couple of parameters that one has to tune. One parameter is how big is your initialization batch. Another parameter is where do you set the reliability threshold that determines whether you accept or reject the measurement. And the third parameter is how large of a memory set are you carrying with you as you process measurements in a streaming way. For all these parameters, we have a way to fix them. We know, for example, that the higher the memory, the better we are in resisting outliers, but the poorer we are in adapting to changes. Of course, that makes sense. For the batch, well, the more the better. But again, if you set the initial batch too high, then you defeat the streaming nature of the solution. And then for the threshold, there are multiple ways one can do that. But really what we do is we set it based on the measurements that we have in the initial batch. So we set it to the median reliability of the measurements in the initial batch. So we solve the problem very easily with a very simple rule of thumb for setting the threshold of accepting or rejecting a measurement based on reliability. Okay, now last, I would like to show you some numerical studies so that I leave some time for questions in case you have. So here we consider again that we have tensor data measurements, XT, they are arriving in a streaming way. So this T stands for the incremental index of this measurement. And we assume that all these measurements have are built by the same basis, but using a different core. And they have added, there is a different noise tensor added to them. Here we have specified what is the SNR that regulates the relationship between the norm of G and the norm of N. And also we assume that one measurement is corrupted with an additive outlier tensor that has outlier to noise ratio 17 dB. So a very strong outlier in one measurement. Also we make the assumption that in total we have 100 measurements. The first 70 are created using a fixed set of bases and the last 30 are created using a different set of bases. So we have a change in the subspace of the source, a change that we want to capture actually, and due to the dynamic nature of our solution. So here I'm plotting the mean normalized squared error for the proposed method, which is the blue, the DL1 tagger, together with other methods that have been proposed for dynamic tensor analysis. For example, this DTA is a very standard method for dynamic tensor analysis, LRUT. I'm also plotting the performance of HOSVD instantaneously. So HOSVD on its new measurement. Apparently this has no memory and therefore it cannot work too well. And we see that the proposed method drill, and I have indicated here as vertical lines where the outlier is. So this measurement is outlier corrupted and where the scene, the subspaces change. So see the proposed method very quickly goes to the lower performance. It totally disregards the outlier. And then of course it gives an error when the background changes, but then quickly it adapts it. If you evaluate the robustness against the outliers and how low the error is in the steady state, and then how quickly we adjust to the subspace changes, you will see that the proposed method is actually arguably preferred over all other methods. For example, this DTA, this red line with the filled triangle marker, you see that same as ours, quickly it finds, it gives you low error, but then when an outlier occurs, look how much it is affected and how much time it takes for it to recover, right? And then yes, it adjusts a little, it adapts a little faster at the early steps here for to the subspace change, but this comes at the expense of lack of any robustness against outliers. Now we have some figures that show the reliability of every of the method, and really these are figures that explain exactly how the method works, but I think that would be too much detail at this point. So with that, I would like to thank people that have collaborated for these papers that I presented. Our collaborator from AFRL, Dr. Ashley Prater-Bennett, my students and research, PhD candidates and research assistants in my lab, Dimitris Kaklakis and Mayur Danarads, and also our sponsors, the National Science Foundation and the Air Force Research Lab, under multiple grants, including the Young Investigator Program Award of 2020. And of course, RIT for making this research possible. All right, as conclusions, we motivated L1 Tucker, we formulated, we saw how we can solve it. We presented the efficient and approximate algorithms for its solution. And I presented also a dynamic algorithm for solving L1 Tucker for streaming data. And we also saw numerical studies from synthetic and real data. All right, you can go to the website of our lab, miloslab.org, and you will you can find there the codes for our algorithms and all our papers in this area. Thank you very much for your attention. And please let me know if you have any questions that I could answer.
So please feel free to jump in and ask any questions.
Oh, for those who are shy, you can also write on the chat bar and we could read for you.
I have a question, and so first of all, thank you so much, Professor, for this such a beautiful presentation. It was really informative to me. I hope for everyone. So I have two questions. The one is more question. The other one is suggestion, actually. So you show us the performance for comparing with the KNN and other things. So I want to sure you didn't show us the comparison of the how expensive the computationally this method compared to the other. So do you have kind of an does it increase the computation? Does it make it less computation? This is the question. And the second one is when you showed it in the dynamic tensor decomposition in the streaming application. So for each reading, when you get in the stream, let's imagine that you're getting from the image. So in a camera, it's 30 frames per second. So applying each frame when you arrive to this decomposition, it wouldn't be expensive. And if that's the case, wouldn't it be nice to have a kind of a batching over there too? It would make much nicer and maybe more robust. That's just a suggestion.
Very, very good points. Thank you, Jalal. With respect to the computation, the method is quite light because it does not claim any computational, any optimality with respect to the metrics. So if I go back just to show in this schematic, so every time we take a new measurement, the first thing is to check its reliability. And that's something that we can do very fast by a couple of matrix multiplications. The next thing is to take this measurement in and put it as an extra measurement in a collection of tensors on which we run L1 tagger. Actually, this runs quite quickly, quite fast, because it's initialized on the previous basis, which are already very good. So at first, it takes you some time to get to the correct basis, and then the refinement is very inexpensive. So actually, this is very good for real time. For real-time processing. Of course, it depends on how big those tensors are, right? But for reasonable tensors that could be, let's say, images, etc., I think that it is doable in real time. Your idea about having a some kind of a buffer there, right?
Yes.
Yeah, I think that's a very good idea. And for practical implementations, definitely one could consider having an extra buffer there.
Yeah.
As needed.
Yeah, I see. Thank you so much. Yeah, that was my question.
Thank you very much.
Well, let's go ahead and give our speaker a great round of applause through your chats or whatever means you want to do it, please. thank you, Panos, very much.
Thank you very much.
Efforts in presenting such an in-depth presentation about tensor and tensor applications. We truly appreciate your time and efforts in this.
Thank you very much. It was a pleasure. Thank you for giving me the stage.
Since I hear no further questions, I would say, Goyo, maybe this is a good time to end the meeting. Please enjoy the rest of your day. Goyo, do you have anything else to add?
No, I think also for panels and anybody else, and later we will have the recorded review. And if for anybody who has some time conflicts right now, today and who cannot join the meeting, and we will have the video recorded, and you and the others could watch online, and probably it takes several days, but eventually they will be there within several days.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
Very nice.
And enjoy the rest of your day.